Well, good morning. If you'd take your seats, we'll go ahead and get started here. Today, we're going to be looking at the Eschatology of Paul, Part 4, which was a series that began several months ago. And as far as I know, this is the last installment on the Eschatology of Paul. There are several passages in the writings of John that I'd like to share with you, the Eschatology of John, and that'll probably happen sometime this summer. Now, I'd like for you to actually turn in your Bibles to 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4. And as I begin today, I'd like to make a few introductory remarks. One of the things that you will discover if I share this information properly and completely is that the Apostle Paul was, in his eschatological view, very interested in warning ahead of time what would happen. And these warnings actually take shape in two specific ways, and we'll be taking a look at both of those as we go along. Another observation that I'd like to make is that because of one of the verses, this particular teaching, this particular presentation might be even more provocative than the previous ones, because it deals with an extremely sensitive issue and principle regarding salvation. And I'll explain what I believe the passage to be teaching and share with you what my thoughts are regarding the matter theologically. And then it's up to you to go back home and take that information, look at the Bible, and determine whether or not what I have shared lines up with what the scriptures actually teach. And we should do that every time anyone speaks, you know, from this podium, whether it's Pastor Steve or John Haller, Charles Atkins, Atkinson, or me, it doesn't matter. We should always be examining the text and the scriptures. And by the way, if I'm not mistaken, John Haller will be back next week doing his prophecy update at his normal time, the second hour. Okay, the Eschatology of Paul, Part 4, and we'll be starting off in 1 Timothy chapter 4, the first three verses. So let's take a look at those first three verses in 1 Timothy chapter 4. Now the Spirit expressly says that in later times some will depart from the faith by devoting themselves to deceitful spirits and the teachings of demons, through the insincerity of liars whose consciences are seared, who forbid marriage and require abstinence from food that God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. Now, while this is an eschatological passage because it talks about the later times, it's one that's not really taught on very frequently. And I'm not quite certain the reason for that, but I want to at least briefly cover this passage and share with you the specifics of what Paul is getting to. Now, you know that the scriptures in the New Testament, specifically, when it uses terms like the last days and the latter days, the last times, depending on the context, it can be any time from the first coming of Christ in terms of his completed, you know, work and ministry. So from the ascension of Christ, you know, until the millennial or the millennial kingdom, the start of the millennial kingdom, and the end of Daniel 70th 7. The latter times or the last days can refer to any time frame along that spectrum. And so we don't know specifically what time frame that Paul had in mind, but this much we do know. His warnings and his emphasis in this passage line up completely and perfectly with the admonitions that Jesus gave in the Olivet Discourse. And they also align themselves with the teaching of the Apostle John in his eschatological passages. Now, this should not surprise us because we know that the Bible has one author, and that's God himself. And he utilized 40 different human authors over a 1,500-year period of time to record what we call the Old and New Testaments. In its original writings, in the original text, it is infallible, it is inerrant, it is authoritative. It is the Word of God himself. It is God-breathed. All Scripture is the product of God himself. We know that the Spirit of God played a major role through those 40 different human authors, and they were borne along as the Spirit carried them and directed them to write what they wrote at a particular time, in a particular culture, utilizing the particular gift that that individual had, the particular education that that individual had. And all of those writings line up, and they are in agreement with each other. The Bible does not contradict itself. As Pastor Steve shared this morning, God is not a God of confusion. I mean, praise God. He has made it clear what his will is. And this text tells us that the Spirit expressly, or it could be translated explicitly, says in the later times that some will fall away from the faith. Now, there's a great debate being waged in the church today regarding salvation, between those people who believe that you can lose your salvation and those people who believe in eternal security. This passage must be addressed regardless of which side of the aisle you were on. What is made clear for us is that the Spirit of God wants us to know that as we draw closer and closer to the end of this age, there will be a phenomenon of demonic deception that will cause some of those who profess to genuinely believe to fall away from the faith. Now, whether or not those people were believers in the first place, I don't know. And that's really at the heart and the core of this issue. But what is clear is that there is going to be deception, and deception on a level that the world has not yet known up to this point in time. Now, the Spirit expressly or explicitly says, if we go back to that slide, thank you, that in later times, some will depart from the faith by devoting themselves to deceitful spirits and the teaching of demons. They will depart from the faith. Now, this is an interesting term. It's the Greek verb aphistemi. It doesn't occur many times in the New Testament. One of the times it does occur is in Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3, I don't have a slide for this, but if you turn in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 3, and I'm going to read for you just one verse. Hebrews chapter 3 and verse 12. The book of Hebrews is full of warnings, and it's written to believers, and I believe we should take these warnings seriously. In chapter 3 and verse 12, the author of Hebrews writes this: "Take care, brothers, lest there be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart leading you to fall away, aphistemi, to fall away from the living God. Here's a direct warning written to believers in the first century. Now, some people have, you know, made the observation that he's writing to Jewish believers who are in danger of returning to Judaism. There are people who have come into their assembly and who want them to go back to placing themselves under the law of Moses. And while that is true, we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that this is a passage, this is a book that was written to genuine believers in Jesus Christ. And there's a warning here not to fall away from the living God. Now, I want you to remember where Hebrews chapter 3 is, because we're going to be returning to this chapter a little later on. Okay, let's go ahead and take a look at the next slide. Jesus answered them, "See that no one leads you astray, for many will come in my name saying, 'I am the Christ,' and they will lead many astray." Then in verse 11, this is in the Olivet Discourse, by the way, Matthew's account, "Many false prophets will arise and lead many astray." And then again, a fourth time in verse 24, "For false Christs and false prophets will arise and perform great signs and wonders so as to lead astray, if possible, even the elect." Even the elect, if possible, will be led astray. That's how incredibly powerful, incredibly persuasive this demonic deception will be. And it will be orchestrated by none other than Satan himself, who is known as the deceiver. He is the deceiver. He is a liar and the father of lies. And in this passage, the Olivet Discourse, when the followers of Jesus Christ asked him, you know, what will be the sign of all of these things? And what will be the sign of your coming? When will all these things take place? Namely, the destruction of the temple and the temple buildings. And what will be the sign of your coming? And he doesn't immediately answer them. In fact, he doesn't give them the sign of his coming until he's 30 verses in to the chapter. And he spends the majority of the chapter warning them about deception, warning them about demonic deception. And it'll take various forms. And he actually begins his response and his answer with this warning to not be led astray. "See that no one leads you astray, for many will come in my name saying, 'I am the Christ,' and they will lead many astray." And there have been many people who have claimed to be Jesus Christ down through the centuries. And there will be one who will claim to be God in the flesh, who will deceive the majority of this planet. And of course, I'm speaking of that future world leader known as the Antichrist, the son of the destruction, the man of lawlessness, called the little horn by Daniel in his prophecy. This deception will also come from many false prophets, pseudo-prophetoi, many false prophets. "For false Christs and false prophets will arise and perform great signs and wonders so as to lead astray, if possible, even the elect. I can't emphasize to you enough the importance of recognizing the emphasis of Jesus Christ in this passage. He is warning against demonic deception. They're interested in the signs. They're interested in the timing. They're interested in what is happening on planet Earth when Jesus comes back to set up his kingdom. And he's telling them, before I come, there will be deception like the world has never known. And you need to be ready for it. You need to be prepared for it. And it's one of the focal points, not only of Jesus, but also of the Apostle Paul. This warning of demonic deception in the last days. And we've all recognized vestiges of it or examples of it. Sometimes that deception comes into the church itself. Sometimes it affects and impacts godly leaders who we at one time trusted and followed. We need to be aware. We need to be alert. We need to be ready for what is coming. Jesus, Paul, the Apostle John all say, all declare that deception is coming, and you better be ready. Now, how do we prepare ourselves for deception? By immersing ourselves in the truth. By reading and meditating and studying the Word of God. By listening to good, solid Bible teaching. By spending time with fellow brothers and sisters in Christ who will encourage one another to stay awake and to be alert and to be ready for the coming of our Lord. Okay, let's go ahead and move on to the next slide. Now, I've recorded for you here two separate verses, two separate books, Matthew 24 and Mark 13. Those are the accounts of the Olivet Discourse from Matthew and Mark's point of view. And in each of those accounts, it is recorded that Jesus told them, he was warning them in advance. He was telling them these things beforehand so that they would be ready, so that they would be prepared, so that they wouldn't be caught off guard. That's why he's doing it. That's why he's emphasizing it. And that's why the apostles in their letters underscored the things that they did when they wrote about eschatology, when they wrote about the doctrine of last things, because they were following the lead of Jesus Christ. Because he taught and instructed them. See, I have told you beforehand. Mark says it even more strongly, but be on guard. I have told you all things beforehand. He's telling them these things so that they can be on the alert, so that they won't be taken by surprise. Do you understand that the enemy is powerful and he roams about like a roaring lion? And if we try to engage him in the flesh, in the power of our own flesh, without the Word of God, without the leading of the Spirit of God, without the armor of God, we're in trouble. If we try to deal with temptation apart from the truth of God's Word, apart from the ministry of the Holy Spirit in our lives, we're in desperate trouble. Satan is a master at presenting opportunities to disobey the will of God in such a way that it appears attractive to the genuine believer, that it makes sense. We call it rationalizing, right? It seems to be the right thing to do. We need to be on guard. Satan knows what our weaknesses are. The demons know those sins that we struggle with. The kingdom of darkness is well aware of the old man that wages war within us. Now, granted, positionally speaking, the old man is dead. Praise God. Hallelujah. He has no lasting power over us. But if we were honest with one another today, we would all admit that the old man on a daily basis raises his or her ugly head and reminds us of who we used to be. Every day, it's a struggle. But thanks be to God, we will someday be delivered from this body. Thanks be to God, someday the old man, practically speaking, will be no more. But until that time, we have to be on guard. We have to be alert. We have to be ready. We have to be encouraging one another. Now, I mentioned last week the practice on the part of some proclaimers of God's word to totally avoid the area of prophecy. Do you understand? Do you understand how that is the will of Satan for a pastor to never speak or preach or unpack the prophetic word? How can we possibly be ready if we don't know what's coming our way? How can we possibly be ready if we don't know the practical commands that are attached to every major prophetic passage that I know of in the Word of God? God has given us His prophetic word for two primary reasons. I've been emphasizing one of those reasons in this series. But there's also another reason God has given His prophetic word. God has predicted the future so that those who are proclaiming His truth might be recognized as being sent from God and might be recognized as His authorized agents. God uses predictive prophecy in order to authorize His prophets and His apostles, and in order to verify the writings that they produce, which we call our Bible. That's a primary purpose of predictive prophecy, so that we might recognize the prophets and the apostles and the foundation that they represent with regard to the Church of Jesus Christ, and that we might be receptive to the word that they recorded down through the centuries. Now, a second purpose, and this is the one that I've been emphasizing through this series, is that the purpose of prophecy is to teach us how to live today in light of what God says will happen tomorrow. So, Jesus says in Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 21, There's going to be persecution. There's going to be demonic deception. You should be alert. You should be awake. I mean, look at the end of the 25th chapter of Matthew's gospel. Look at the end of the 13th chapter of Mark's gospel. Look at the end of the 21st chapter of Luke's gospel. They all have the same emphasis. Be alert, be awake, be on guard. Be spiritually prepared as one of my followers. That's what Jesus wants. He wants us to be part of a spiritual army. That's why he's given us spiritual armor. We're involved in a battle. And our enemy desires our destruction. We shouldn't be flirting with the forces of evil. We shouldn't be engaging with regard to lifestyle, the kingdom of darkness. We should be pursuing those things that God wants us to do. We should be thinking those things that God wants us to think, so that we might live in a way that is worthy of God himself. Now, talk about the grace of God. Talk about the wonder of all wonders. God desires for us to live in such a way that it will bring honor and glory to him. That just sends chills down my spine. And they're good chills. I mean, what a God we serve. What a creator we know. What a God we love. Okay, let's take a look at that next slide. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. You know, Pastor Steve, I would get around to going back to this passage sooner rather than later. We've already unpacked this passage in depth. If you're interested, you can listen to my teaching on the eschatology of Paul part 2. Or you could also take a look at the series that I did on the Day of the Lord, in which I spent an entire week in an eight-week series on 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. That was back in, my goodness, it'll be 3 years ago this summer that happened. I've lost a year along the way somehow. Keep wanting to say it was 2 years ago. It's almost 3 years ago now we did that series. So I'm just going to emphasize one thing here. I'm not going to unpack the Day of the Lord or the falling away by the professing church. That's mentioned. For that day will not come unless the rebellion comes first and the man of lawlessness is revealed. We know from the context, the man of lawlessness, the Antichrist, the son of destruction, will be revealed at the midpoint when he takes his seat in the temple, displaying himself as being God. We know that's when it happens. Prior to that happening, though, the professing church is going to fall away and depart from the truth. That goes right along with 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1, does it not? What I want to focus on is the very first sentence. Let no one deceive you in any way. Let no one deceive you in any way. Now, the context for that declaration, when Paul wrote 1 Thessalonians, he gave them teaching regarding the day of the Lord and the fact that they wouldn't go through the day of the Lord. According to 1 Thessalonians chapter 1 and verse 10 and 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 9. By the way, Pastor Steve, I think I might have flipped those verses last week. So if need be, the Department of Corrections clearly states those references are 1 Thess 1:10 and 1 Thess 5:9. We will be delivered from the wrath to come. That's a reference to the day of the Lord. False teachers came in, taught that the day of the Lord had already come. They thought they had missed the resurrection and the rapture, and it shook them to the very core of their faith. And so Paul had to write 2 Thessalonians, and in particular 2 Thessalonians 2, and let them know that certain things had to happen before the day of the Lord begins. Namely, here's two elements: the falling away from the truth by the professing church and the unveiling of the man of lawlessness at the midpoint of Daniel 77. Now, understand one thing. This declaration is in the very heart of a prophetic passage. Let no one deceive you in any way. It's an interesting word that's used here. It's not the word that Jesus used four different times in Matthew 24. The Greek verb planao, see to it that no one leads you astray, planao. The actual word that Paul employs here is ex apatao. And it's a compound verb. Apatao just means deceive. When you put the prefix ex, it intensifies the meaning of the verb. Let no one utterly deceive you in any way. I mean, that's how powerful that verb is. When it comes to the prophetic word, do not be under any form of deception, because that deception ultimately comes from the pit. Now, Pastor Steve's been doing a series on the role of women in the home and the role of women in the church. Boy, talk about a glutton for punishment. I have enjoyed sitting under your teaching. And today was no exception. And that was a difficult passage and a difficult concept. And he, at the very end, touched on a passage that employs this very word. And that passage serves to illustrate for us the meaning of the word, even though it's not a prophetic passage. And I'd like for us to turn to 1 Timothy chapter 2, the passage where Pastor Steve spent at least the latter portion of his message. By the way, if you're watching this and you didn't hear that sermon or that message, you need to hear it. And let me share this encouragement. And I don't know that I've ever done this before. I don't know that I've ever been affected and impacted by an opening prayer as I was this morning. We were translated to the very throne room of heaven itself when our pastor prayed. The theology in that prayer and the heartfelt expression that you offered touched me in a way that I've rarely been touched. And I want to say thank you for taking the time to pray publicly. And for those of you who heard it but missed it, go back and listen again. It's that powerful. Okay. I'm going to be reading from 1 Timothy, if I can turn to it here. 1 Timothy chapter 2. And in this passage, Paul is teaching that he wants women in the context of the local church to not be teaching or exercising authority over men. He makes a very direct statement here. I do not permit a woman to teach or to exercise authority over a man. Rather, she is to remain quiet. Now, here's why Paul wrote that. And it has nothing to do with culture. And this is what our pastor believes. It has nothing to do with culture in this passage. In other passages, cultural considerations are considered, but not in this passage. Look at what he says. For Adam was formed first, then Eve. He's talking about the order of creation. In what culture on this planet, since the creation of Adam and Eve, has the reality of Adam being created first before Eve not been true? Not a rhetorical question. None. No culture has ever existed where Adam wasn't created first. And I'm talking about capital T truth here, not about what people believe or don't believe. Do you catch that? Adam was created first. If Eve had been created first, Jerry would be up here and not me. Do you understand? Paul goes on. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. Now, this is where English doesn't serve us well. It's a great language. Don't get me wrong. I love the English language. So much so that I minored in English, even though I didn't need to, when I attended the Ohio State University. Notice I don't say the Ohio State University, because it's the Ohio State University. Paul uses two different Greek verbs. He uses apatao for Adam. Adam wasn't deceived, but Eve was ex apatao. That compound verb where the verb is made much stronger and much more intense with the addition of that prefix. The man who taught me Greek at Grace Theological Seminary, Professor John Sproul, he loved to preach, he loved to teach, and one of the things that he taught me, this passage could easily be translated, Adam was not deceived, but the woman being utterly deceived became a transgressor. So the order of creation and the order of the fall have always been true for every culture down through the ages. And Paul bases his admonition on women not teaching or exercising authority over men, I believe in the context of the local church, on those two unchanging, non-negotiable, ever-present principles, which are transcultural. Is that good enough? Okay. All right. By the way, Pastor Steve believes every word that I just shared, I think. Okay. There's some things we disagree on.
Utterly.
Thank you. Wow, that is just so good. It's so you. Oh, my. Okay. So, do you understand why I go to that passage? Paul's making a point, and he's emphasizing the depth of the deception. And who deceived her? Satan. Satan deceived her. Now, Paul uses this word with regard to Eve in one of the Corinthian epistles, and I don't have the address in my head right now, I apologize, but I know it's in one of the Corinthian epistles, where he talks about this event where Eve was deceived. He uses the exact same verb, ex apatao, and he specifically mentions Satan being the deceiver when she was deceived. Don't miss the emphasis of this, the importance of this. It's demonic deception, but it ultimately has its origin in satanic deception. Understand what I'm saying here. I'm not saying that Satan is responsible for everything. I'm saying the demons rank under him from an authority point of view. He is the prince of darkness. He is the god of this world, little g. And his demons carry out those things he desires. Okay, let's go to the next slide if we could, please. Oh, here we go. Here's the provocative element of the teaching. And it's good that I'm running out of time because this is where I'm going to get myself in trouble if I do. Yeah, it is a crowded room today. So remember that I told you that that the Apostle Paul is emphasizing two different things in his warnings within the prophetic word. He's emphasizing this principle of demonic deception on the one hand, and on the other hand, he's warning against falling away. He's warning against falling away. Demonic deception, don't fall away. Those, you know, are the dual clarion calls of 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 1. Now, I put up these verses because they speak to the issue of falling away and what that means with respect and with regard to the believer. As you know, the apostle or the apostolic associate that wrote the book of Hebrews, and by the way, I don't know who wrote the book of Hebrews, records here in verse 6, he's talking about Jesus being superior and superior over Moses. He's superior to Moses in Hebrews chapter 3. And he said in the previous verse that Moses, you know, was faithful as a servant in God's house, but Christ is faithful as the builder of the house. And he says, Christ is faithful over God's house as a son, and we are his house, if we hold fast. Wow. Now, what does that immediately cause your minds to think about? Well, for some, maybe not all, but for some of you, you might be thinking about, well, what about eternal security? To which I respond, what about eternal security? Let's go on. If indeed we hold fast our confidence and our boasting in our hope. In other words, we demonstrate ourselves to be the house of God to the extent that we hold fast our confidence in the hope that is found in Jesus Christ. Let's look at verse 14. For we have come to share in Christ. That's a statement of genuine belief. Would you all not agree? For we have come to share in Christ if indeed we hold our original confidence firm to the end. Does that mean if you don't hold fast, firm to the end, you know, you lose that standing? Some people teach that. Now, I don't personally hold that position. I believe, personally, that these are genuine warning passages. And the warning is to believers to hold fast in confidence the hope that is found in Jesus Christ. And to hold fast our original confidence firm until the end. Now, when does the end come for the believer? There's one of two possibilities, and there's only two, if I read my Bible correctly. Is that correct? There's only two possibilities for the end. The end, which is experienced in physical death, right? Absent from the body, present with the Lord, and those who are alive and remain at the coming of our Lord, who are changed in a moment in the twinkling of an eye. 1 Thessalonians 4, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the resurrection and the rapture. Until the end. We demonstrate ourselves to be believers by the manner in which we live. Now, what does the Bible say about someone who says they're a believer, but they live like an unbeliever? Does anybody know? It speaks to that person. It speaks to that principle. And in a nutshell, here's what it says. For the believer who is currently living, now understand me now, I'm not talking about an individual act of sin. I'm talking about a lifestyle of unbelief. You understand the difference, right? Someone who is living a lifestyle of unbelief, they cannot know whether or not they're saved. And they will not know whether or not they are saved unless they do something. And what is that one word something they must do? Repent. They must repent, and if they don't, they cannot possibly have assurance of their salvation. Now, that's a different deal than losing your salvation. Would you not agree? But it's still a powerful warning. It's still a powerful warning. And as I mentioned earlier, you know, these passages in Hebrews, sometimes they are relegated to, oh, that's only for believing Jews who want to go back under the law of Moses, because that's who the author of Hebrews was writing to. Well, if you want to take that approach, I offer you the next slide, and if we can take a look at that. Check this one out. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Oh, this is the passage on the gospel that I shared in a message, late last year, I think it might have been. Now, I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel, the good news I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you. These are not Jewish believers. These are Gentile believers who are embracing pagan practices, some of them. And they're being called to repent in the Corinthian epistles. And the Apostle Paul is saying, you know, you can know that you are being saved if you hold fast to the word I preached to you. Now, you know my position, and you know that it's not not all that controversial, but it has a provocative element to it. And I do need to explain this and spell this out for you, because I think this is vitally important for believers in the body of Christ, especially those who believe in the doctrine of eternal security. Have you ever heard the phrase, once saved, always saved? I actually had someone share to me one time that once saved, always saved relieved them of responsibilities going forward. In this sense, that they couldn't lose that salvation. You understand what I'm saying? Okay, now, that is not the emphasis of the Word of God. It just simply is not. And nowhere in the Word of God does it say, come to Christ and live like a pirate. Doesn't say that. Come to Christ and revel in your unbelief. Doesn't say that. It says, come to Christ and follow Him. Live lifestyles of holiness. Live lives which are pleasing to the Father. Once saved, always saved. If you say it too fast, it's dangerous because of what you don't say. If you ever share with someone, once saved, always saved, you should always say, but of course the Bible also teaches that genuine believers will persevere to the end. And you can't know for certain that you're a believer unless you're living for Christ in that moment. So, do I believe in eternal security? Absolutely. But I also believe that we're called to hold firm, faithful unto the end. And that God calls us to persevere and be overwhelming conquerors through Christ Jesus, our Lord. Now, how can we possibly be overwhelming conquerors from God's point of view if we're dabbling in lifestyles which are embraced by the world and which are held up for display by the kingdom of darkness? God wants us to live for Him. God wants us to live today in a way that will bring honor and glory to Him, in a way that will please Him, because of what He says will happen tomorrow. The Christian life is all about embracing those principles, being ready, being prepared, being alert, because we're conscious and aware of demonic deception. And we know the reality that there will be some who profess to believe, some that we might have known for decades, in that belief who will fall away in the later times. That's a sobering reality. And we need to be encouraging one another, building up one another, sharing with one another these principles and these truths until Jesus returns. Now, it's interesting, and I'm going to close with this. And I also don't have a slide for this. In the 12th chapter of the book of Revelation, Satan is identified for us two different ways. On the one hand, he's referred to as the dragon, right? And on the other hand, he's referred to as the serpent. The dragon is the destroyer who's all about persecution and tribulation. Let me say that again. The dragon is the destroyer who is all about persecution and tribulation. The serpent is about deception. Our enemy is a deceiver who wants to destroy us, which is why God has given us these warning principles in the prophetic text. Because as Satan gets closer and closer to the end, you know what Revelation 12 says, right? He's filled with great fury because he knows his time is limited. And in the context of Revelation 12, there, where that verse appears, he knows that it is going to last for 1,260 more days until he's literally thrown into a pit and secured there with a great chain. He knows his Bible. More importantly, he believes the Bible. Now think about that. He doesn't believe in God in the sense that he can be saved, but he knows who God is. And he knows God's plan. And he knows his destiny. And there's nothing he can do about it except inflict his fury and rage. Here upon this earth. Wow. This was much heavier than I thought it was going to be. Heavy sigh. So ends the Eschatology of Paul, Part 4. And if I remember correctly, what's the next slide? Yes, let's pray. Father, thank you for this day, for this time. Father, thank you for your word. We pray that we would take it to heart. Father, we pray that we would be ready and prepared, that we would be living our lives in light of your Son's return. Father, we love you so much. We thank you for sending your Son, for sending your Spirit, for giving us your word. Father, today I especially want to thank you for your grace. As a people, we are who we are by the grace of God. And I thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen.